isn't anything I won't do now to enlist your aid in freeing me of the curse of the Draculas.
Draculas?
Yes. I am Dracula's daughter.
As you might remember, almost exactly a year ago, Netflix released and then very quickly canceled First Kill, a show that centered around the romance between a vampire and vampire hunter, tale as old as time. As progressive as the show was on many fronts, namely with its diverse cast, I don't think it would have cultivated quite the fan base it did if it weren't for one particularly progressive aspect. The lead romance was between two teenage girls. It was overt, it was steamy, it made you want to become well acquainted with your high-pressure showerhead for the night. Well, not you as in me, because they're teenagers and that's disgusting, but you know what I mean, it was very gay. Whether First Kill had your unlimited support or you couldn't get past the first few episodes because it felt too Riverdale-esque, which is kind of the side I'm on, it's impossible to deny that such a large streaming service putting up a show like this was a really big deal and progressive, even if it only lasted a short while. However, First Kill was far from the first time this kind of romance has been seen on screen in popular media. The lesbian vampire trope has actually been around for hundreds of years and has different origin points depending on who you ask. Some people trace it back to Elizabeth Bathory's reign of terror on women in the 16th century, but I personally think that the first official lesbian vampire we got in popular media came from Carmilla, which was a novella written by Sheridan Le Fanu, an Irish author, and published in 1872, which, by the way, predates Bram Stoker's Dracula by 26 years. So before I fully dive into Carmilla, I first want to introduce The Vampire Lovers, which was a film directed by Roy Ward Baker and released in 1970. Although I do have a few gripes with this film, it's a pretty faithful adaptation of Carmilla, which is why I'm going to use it as the foundation for this section of the video, just to have something a little more visually interesting on screen. Any significant differences between Carmilla and The Vampire Lovers will be noted, but there are very few. With that being said, The Vampire Lovers begins with an extravagant ball thrown by General Spielsdorf in his isolated castle in Austria for his niece, Laura. At this event, Laura and her uncle meet a countess and her beautiful daughter, a young woman named Marcilla. The Countess has just received terrible news and needs to rush to the bedside of a sick relative in another town and isn't able to take her daughter with her. With a bit of persistence from both the Countess and Laura, who has grown a liking to Marcilla, General Spielsdorf agrees to take care of the girl for however long the trip should take. In the following days, the relationship between Laura and Marcilla grows stronger with very palpable romantic tension. We even see a kiss shared between the two women, notably initiated by Marcilla. Shortly after, Laura starts to have these strange nightmares, followed by inexplicable anemia and then, very quickly, her death. When examined by a doctor, two puncture wounds are found on Laura's breast, and Marcilla seems to disappear into thin air. As the story continues, we're introduced to Emma as she receives the news of Laura, her best friend's, death. Emma is very similar to Laura in that she lives in a remote castle with her father and a handful of house servants. Considering their similarity in age, Laura was Emma's only friend, and now that she's gone, Emma is in a particularly vulnerable state. Keep that in mind. Luckily for Emma, she and her father run into a countess in the woods who begs them to take care of her daughter Carmilla while she continues forward on an urgent journey to visit a sick relative. A story that, at this point, we can tell she's practiced a few times. Emma and her father agree to this arrangement, and Carmilla, who was previously known as Marcilla to us, has thus been invited into their lives. Similarly to the relationship between Laura and Marcilla, the relationship between Emma and Carmilla grows very romantic and, dare I say, sexual very quickly. And I mean, like, overtly sexual. There's this scene where Emma and Carmilla are play fighting naked, and it ends with Carmilla laying on top of Emma on Emma's bed. And, like, if that's not the beginning of some old VHS porn you would find in your granddad's basement, I don't know what would be. I think what's especially crazy to me is that the actress for Carmilla, Ingrid Pitt, vehemently denied any lesbian undertones, which I think are overtones, quite frankly, in this film. In one of her last interviews, she said, "It didn't really strike me that The Vampire Lovers was a lesbian-based story, which I think is ridiculous and probably rooted in homophobia. But the great thing about art and media is that we're allowed to interpret it however we wish, and I'm definitely not alone in thinking that Carmilla is a lesbian vampire. And if I haven't convinced you to think the same thing yet, there's this scene."
Pulling her gently towards him, he showered her sweet upturned face with manly kisses. "This is a silly book."
"But it's a lovely story." "Don't you wish some handsome young man would come into your life?"
"No, neither do you, I hope."
"I'd like to see one."
Which pretty explicitly establishes Carmilla as someone opposed to having a male partner. And if that's still not enough, there's this scene.
"My poor darling."
And, like, they have sex. No, it's not on screen, but it is heavily implied. I just feel so passionate about Carmilla's label as a lesbian vampire because, A, that's what this video is about, but also I'm just really disappointed in Ingrid Pitt for trying to denounce any lesbian themes going on in this film when they're in your face, honestly. I just think it's harmful and irresponsible, but she has the right to feel however she wants, so, you know, I'll leave it at that. Anyways, just after the scene, Emma reveals two puncture wounds she found on her breast to her governess, Madame Perdon, with no idea how they got there. We, however, are in the know and know of Carmilla's status as a vampire. Something I think is particularly fascinating here is the vampire bite itself, because a bite on the breast insinuates intimacy that a bite on the neck doesn't. Every character's neck is exposed throughout the film, leaving that particularly vulnerable area easily accessible to Carmilla, but she doesn't always go for what's easiest to access. In the case of both Emma and Laura, sexual desire and seduction had to be involved in the process where tops were removed in intimate settings. And by the way, Carmilla is perfectly capable of biting necks. We see that later on in the film, but it's only ever with male victims. Further than that, Carmilla's bites on the breasts of her victims serve as an act of penetration. She is empowered by the ability to penetrate during sex despite lacking an eggplant, which is a dangerous thing for a woman to be able to do because it upsets that male-female dynamic that has been traditionally established. So keep that in mind because we'll come back to it. This is a theme we see a lot in these lesbian vampire stories. Shortly after Emma reveals these bites to her concerned governess, Carmilla seduces Madame Perdon. It's unclear if they have sex or if Carmilla bites her, but either way, the governess comes out of the situation entirely faithful to Carmilla and her desires, completely disregarding the well-being of Emma. She might even be a vampire herself at this point, it's not entirely clear. Emma becomes really sick, and after being seen by a male doctor, another house servant named Renton starts to suspect that Madame Perrodon is the vampire who bit Emma and subsequently puts garlic flowers by her bedside for protection. Emma's father has gone away on a business trip, so Renton is the only protective male figure in the castle and takes this position very seriously. In a matter of minutes, Carmilla kills the doctor with a bite on the neck and seduces Renton in order to make him remove the garlic flowers. This part, in my opinion, really drives home that idea that sexually active women are dangerous because they have the ability to turn even the most obnoxiously loyal men unloyal. As the film starts to build in tension, General Spielsdorf, who, if you don't remember, was Laura's uncle, tells Emma's father of his suspicions that Marcilla was a vampire who caused his niece's death. The two men also meet with a local vampire hunter and Emma's fiancé, who I didn't realize was even in a relationship with her until this point in the movie, on a journey to Karnstein Castle, where the vampire hunter says Marcilla lives. Once inside the castle, the group of men discovers that Countess Mircalla Karnstein, who supposedly died centuries earlier, has since become a vampire whose aliases are anagrams of each other, hence the names Marcilla and Carmilla. Once this revelation is made, Emma's fiancé rushes back to the castle to save her. In the meantime, Carmilla kills both Renton and Madame Perrodon and attempts to take the very weak Emma away from the castle. However, Emma's fiancé shows up in the nick of time to fight off Carmilla and hold Emma in his arms as she realizes Carmilla's true nature. Mid-fight, Carmilla disappears and rematerializes in Karnstein Castle, where Emma's dad, General Spielsdorf, and the vampire hunter wait for her. Carmilla is then stabbed through the heart with a wooden stake and decapitated, ending her reign of terror forever. So, remember my whole spiel about vampire bites? Well, there's nothing quite like shoving a phallic-shaped object into the heart of the lesbian vampire to reinstate natural order. The masculine body reestablishes itself as in control of the feminine one, and all is well. In short, while the vampire bite is penetrative, a stake through the heart is the ultimate penetration. While Carmilla's character was unprecedented for the 19th century, it's not lost on me that one of the only, if not the only, lesbian representation at the time ended with the lesbian in question dying in the end. This idea inspired the title of this video because it's hard for me to feel like this archetype has historically been progressive when the surrounding characters always want her dead and succeed. It's sending a pretty clear message that attempts to establish heterosexuality as morally right, and in The Vampire Lovers, this is really drilled into your head by the end when Carmilla drives Emma into the arms of her fiancé. The underlying message in this film is that lesbianism is unnatural and unholy, much like vampires themselves. Jumping to 1936, I want to take a look at Lambert Hillier's Dracula's Daughter, a film that, despite having a lesbian or bisexual vampire, takes a lot more effort to conceal her sexuality, at least in comparison to The Vampire Lovers. But I will note that this film came out just 2 years after the Hays Code was instated, which, if you don't know, was a set of guidelines that heavily censored what could be shown in films during the golden age of Hollywood, from profanity to violence to homosexuality and beyond. So that is something to keep in mind. In Dracula's Daughter, we're introduced to Maria Zaleska, the titular character after the death of her father. She desperately wants to get rid of her vampirism and seeks out the advice of Dr. Garth, a psychiatrist who specializes in hypnosis, although she doesn't reveal to him her cravings for human blood. Dr. Garth advises Maria to sit in a space with her craving and actively resist the urge to indulge, a technique which I feel like would be helpful to literally no one ever, but she obliges. That night, Maria asks her assistant, Sander, to lure a potential victim into her private art studio. Sander finds a young woman named Lily standing alone by the edge of a river, looking very lost. She seemingly doesn't have anywhere to go as she's tempted by Sander's promise to bring her to a warm place and follows him. Although she's acting of free will, she's understandably very apprehensive, which makes the scene really difficult to watch. When Lily eventually enters the studio, Maria explains that she's there as a portrait model, which requires Lily to remove her blouse and pull down her undershirt in a scene that feels very sensual by this film's standards. Only a few seconds later does Maria give in to her urges, first hypnotizing Lily with her ring and then attacking. This scene presents a critique of lesbianism that we see very often with the lesbian vampire character, where she opts to prey on the most vulnerable women. And we normally see this in the way that she chooses to attack young women who, in theory, can't protect themselves. Not only does Lily fit into this mold, but she's also homeless, I think, and she's in search of food. So it's not like she came to Maria for the fun of it, she just really had nowhere else to go. When the lesbian vampire chooses these victims, she paints herself as a monster that you're supposed to root against, even if she is beautiful. Further than that, the lesbian vampire also always chooses young, pretty women to prey on, which subsequently removes them from the heterosexual dating pool. And by taking these valuable women off the market, the lesbian vampire really becomes a threat to the straight man and his ability to fulfill his sexual desires. So now, she must be killed. I do want to note that Maria's victims in this film are both men and women, but the film places an emphasis on the latter demographic. I think part of that comes from this very old-fashioned mindset where men should be able to protect themselves from any female attackers. But on top of that, Maria is very beautiful, and it should be something that these men want. So it's not taken as seriously. You know, obviously a very ridiculous mindset to hold, especially when the attractive woman in question is literally superhuman with like crazy strength and speed. But anyways, Lily is not immediately killed by Maria. Instead, she's found unresponsive the next day with two puncture wounds on her neck. Upon examination, Dr. Garth claims that Lily is in a post-hypnosis state. This solidifies the fact that Maria uses her ring to hypnotize her victims, which we already knew. What I find interesting about this rendition of the lesbian vampire is where Carmilla used her body to seduce her victims, Maria used something outside of her body to achieve the same effect. Soon after this diagnosis, Lily dies in the hospital. Maria meets Dr. Garth again and begs him to save her soul, claiming that she has to obey her obsession.
You're a great doctor, a doctor of minds, of souls. I need you, Dr. Garth. I need you to save my soul.
How can you expect me even to listen to you when you're concealing the truth about yourself?
But I've told you all I can now.
You mean you've told me all you dare?
I can't help but feel like asking a man to save her soul insinuates that Maria's lesbianism slash vampirism is unholy, but if she can get this man to fix her and fix her sexuality, she'll become righteous again. Which is not the best message to send. Just after this conversation, Maria and Sander kidnap Dr. Garth's beautiful and headstrong assistant, Janet, and bring her to Maria's castle in Transylvania. Dr. Garth follows behind. At one point, Sander says this.
Beautiful and helpless.
About Janet, which brings us back to the idea that Maria's victims are in vulnerable states when she attacks. It wasn't really a fair fight in the first place, but now it really isn't, which emphasizes the sense of urgency in order for Dr. Garth to save Janet in time. And he does exactly that. Just as Maria leans into what seems like a kiss, honestly, Dr. Garth bursts into the castle and stops her. Maria offers Dr. Garth eternal life, but he refuses, and her attempt to entice the intelligent Dr. Garth fails. Shortly after, Sander shoots Maria in the heart because he feels betrayed by her and is then killed himself. As for Janet, just as the threat of lesbianism looms above her, she is saved by a man and heterosexuality. One of my biggest issues with Dracula's daughter is the way in which her desires, both for young woman and blood, are put in the same boat, seen as this compulsion that she can't control. On one hand, this presents lesbianism as an unwavering trait that can't be fixed whenever you feel like it. Which is a good thing, because I would argue that sexuality can't really be changed at the drop of the hat. But, on the other hand, Maria's sapphic tendencies aren't really portrayed in a positive light. Lesbianism in this film is seen as parasitic and overwhelming and harmful. It's like, as hard as she tries, Maria is unable to indulge in her sapphic tendencies without hurting people in the process. Ultimately, this film paints the lesbian vampire as a predator who needs to be vanquished before she can attack another woman again. If she couldn't be changed and her soul couldn't be saved, she had to be killed. So, the last lesbian / bi vampires that I'm going to be talking about are from Tony Scott's film The Hunger, released in 1983. Now, from what I've heard, The Hunger, which stars Catherine Deneuve, David Bowie, and my queen, Susan Sarandon, was a staple in lesbian culture of the 80s, and I think that largely comes from the, for once, explicit sex scene between two women. No reading between the lines, no insinuating based on clues, it's right there in front of you. God bless the 80s. The Hunger begins with a look into the lives of vampire Miriam Blaylock and her companion, John, who she met and turned in the 18th century. They live in New York and periodically feed on humans together, luring people in with the promise of sex. The couple also trains their neighbor, a young girl named Alice, in cello in their free time. Their relationship is a little more sinister than it seems on the surface, though, as Miriam aims to groom Alice into becoming her next companion when she comes of age. This is obviously really creepy and tells us two things about Miriam at once. A, she's interested in women, and B, she's a predator, which are not two things that should inherently be linked together. I'm also wondering at this point if this is how Miriam also got John to be her companion. Like, does she just have a history of grooming? One day, John begins to rapidly age, and in order to find a solution before he dies, he seeks help from Dr. Sarah Roberts, who specializes in gerontology, the study of aging. Sarah, however, doesn't believe that John is telling the truth, which prompts him to leave. In a last-ditch effort to save himself, John lures Alice into his apartment, attacks her, and feeds, to no avail. John dies, and Miriam puts him in a coffin in their basement, where all of the bodies of her previous companions lie. A while later, Sarah visits the apartment in search of John to talk about his condition, but is, obviously, only met with Miriam. Very quickly, the sexual tension becomes strong, and the two women have sex. During the process, Miriam bites Sarah and transfers some of her blood into her, which begins the process of Sarah's transformation into a vampire. Notably, although the act of sex was consensual, the penetration was not. I also think it's important to note that Sarah is an intelligent and mature woman, which is drastically different from the victims we've seen in previous films. Even so, she still falls under Miriam's spell very quickly. This presents the idea that lesbianism and vampirism in conjunction can affect even the strongest of women, which makes the lesbian vampire even more terrifying. Sarah becomes really sick in the following days, spending her time in Miriam's guest bedroom, incapacitated. Sarah's boyfriend, Tom, comes to Miriam's apartment in search of his girlfriend. Miriam agrees to bring him to Sarah, and when she does, Sarah kills and feeds on him. Something I want to point out here is the way in which this disease, whether interpreted as lesbianism or vampirism or both, is parasitic. It passes from victim to victim, invading their minds and taking over their bodies, killing them slowly. It's not an affliction that has any positive connotations. Now that she has a bit of energy, Sarah and Miriam kiss just after Tom is killed. In a shocking twist, Sarah stabs herself in the throat during the kiss while forcefully holding Miriam's lips to hers so she ingests Sarah's blood. Now at the climax of the film, Miriam begins to rapidly age, soon meeting the same fate John did before her. Kind of interesting to see how Sarah gets her revenge with this exchange of non-consensual fluids. A while later, Sarah is in London with who I would say are her two new companions, one of which, the woman, she kisses. In a dark room, Miriam's mummified body lies in a casket where she'll live for eternity, calling Sarah's name to no answer. I think the ending is definitely up to your own interpretation, but I see Sarah is still afflicted by this disease that she killed someone to get rid of, and is also passing it on to another woman. Not only does this reinforce that parasite analogy of lesbianism slash vampirism, the ending seems to also insinuate that because a man wasn't involved in the death of the sapphic vampire, her curse still lives on. She wasn't vanquished by heterosexuality or penetrated with a wooden stake in the hands of a man, and that's why the story doesn't quite have a happy, holy ending. Even though I don't necessarily feel like homosexuality is presented positively in this film, I will say that it's nice to have the representation. More than anything, The Hunger presents vampirism as the stronger curse that needs to be conquered over lesbianism, which I guess is good. Honestly, I would love to hear opinions from you lovely lesbian ladies out there about all of this. I personally feel like looking at these films from a 2023 perspective makes the lesbian vampire seem a lot more outdated and probably disrespectful than progressive, considering the way that their stories were and how their stories ended. However, I feel like if I was a sapphic woman in the 70s watching The Vampire Lovers for the first time, I would probably just be excited to see a gay character on screen and not necessarily picking them apart or analyzing the ways in which they're a metaphor for the suffocating patriarchy or whatever else, you know? But with that being said, I do think it's fair to critique these films in a way that helps us improve our contemporary representations of the lesbian vampire. First Kill was great because, from what I can remember, Juliet, the lesbian vampire, was a character that you rooted for, and her relationship with Calliope, the vampire hunter, was sweet and consensual and not predatory. They were just teenagers trying to navigate a relationship. I am trying to think of other lesbian vampires in recent media, and the only one I can come up with is Marceline from Adventure Time, who I both wanted to be and had a crush on growing up, and now, let's be honest. Also, she might be bi. But still, I feel like she's a good example of a character who you can empathize with, and that's largely because the surrounding characters don't want her dead. She's also not portrayed as this awful, heartless person, which I think is great, and also probably helps that she doesn't kill innocent women in the process of just existing. She's just a girl, you know? A 1,000-year-old girl. Final verdict, are lesbian vampires really that progressive? Not at first, but then yes, in recent years. This is the most eloquent answer I've ever given. I think just a black and white answer is not fair at all when this archetype has such a complex history, and there's so many different versions of her throughout time. The lesbian vampire has historically been used to both condemn and also provide much needed representation of this sexuality. So the answer's up in the air. Let me know what you think. And that's it. Thank you guys for watching to the end of this video, because I know this was a little long, but also for all the support I got on my last video essay, which was about liminal spaces, if you are interested in watching that at all. Anyways, it is way past my bedtime, so hopefully I will see you soon. Bye!